Today, we're going to be learning how to use PLU factorization to solve a system of equations. Now, we're given a matrix A, a vector X, and a vector B. And what we want to do is we want to split up A into its three matrices. It's P matrix, or its pivot matrix, its L matrix, or lower triangular matrix, and the U matrix, or the upper triangular matrix. And then we'll essentially use those three matrices to solve for the vector X. So let's get started. So we can start out by writing out our initial matrices. So we'll have our U matrix here. Now, right now it's not an upper triangular matrix, but by the end of the video it will be after we walk through the steps. And then we'll have our lower triangular matrix, which essentially means you have your diagonal full of ones and everything above that diagonal will be zero. So then by the end of this video, we'll essentially have a diagonal full of non-zero values, and then we'll have a lower quadrant of essentially zero values for our upper triangular. Now, in our lower triangular, we'll have a couple of factors here, which we will fill out as we solve the problem. So we'll just leave those as x1, x2, and x3 for now. And then we have our pivot matrix. Now, our pivot matrix is essentially an identity matrix, which is essentially a zero matrix with only ones along the diagonal. Now, we'll essentially modify this if we were to switch rows, but we'll get to that in a little bit. Okay, so now that we have our three matrices written out, what we want to do is start to make some operations. So kind of draw our arrow to show some action. Well, first we should probably write these out yet again. So we'll have our U, our L, and we'll have our pivot matrix. So the pivot, what we first want to check is with our first value here in the first row, the first column, is that the largest magnitude number out of these three numbers? And in this case, it is, because 10 would be greater than absolute value of -3, which would be 3, and it's also greater than 5. So we don't have to do any row swapping. And now the reason that we would row swap if something was greater, so let's say this 5 here, let's say that was a 15 instead, then we'd actually want to swap these rows because it leads to a more accurate end result for our x vector. So in this case though, so 10 would be greater than our -3 and our positive 5. So the absolute values, we take those. So it's greater than both, so we don't have to do any swapping. So that means our pivot matrix will actually stay the same. So we can just write that out, and then pivot is good. Now for our lower, we know that the ones and the zeros, those will not change. So now we can start working on the U. So in this case, since we're not doing any switching, our first row will remain as is. And then what we'll want to do is we'll want to essentially get rid of this -3 and this 5 here so that we only have 10 and then 0, 0 underneath for that first column. So now the way we can do this is we can say we'll do row 2 minus, and then we'll essentially take this -3 and divide by 10. So we'll have minus -3 plus 3 divided by 10. So we had that double negative, right? So then in this case, what we'll have is for all of our row 2 values, we'll essentially have minus -3 over 10 times R1. So then that'll cancel out this this -3 here. So we'll have -3 plus 3 divided by 10 times 10, or -3 plus 3. So we'll get 0. And then we can do that for the rest of the row. So then we'll have essentially 2 plus 3 divided by 10 times -7. Which will leave us with -0.1. And then we can do 6 plus 3 divided by 10 times 0, which will just leave 6. Now, the way we start filling out this lower triangular matrix is we take these factors and we actually place them in their corresponding spots. So since we had a factor of -3 divided by 10, because remember we have minus our -3 divided by 10, where this is our factor. So we're essentially taking that factor and we're placing it into our lower triangular matrix. And we place it into this spot because we're augmenting or changing our second row here. So that's why it goes in the second row spot. Now, let's do the third one. So we can say row 3 is gonna be minus, so we're gonna take this 5 and divide it by 10. 5 divided by 10 of our row 1. So essentially, we can right off the bat take that factor of 5 tenths and we can place that in our lower triangular matrix. And then we can kind of walk through the same steps. So we'll have 5 minus 5 divided by 10 times 10, which will give us 0. And we have negative 1 minus 5 divided by 10 times negative 7, which should give us 2.5. And then 5 minus 5 divided by 10 times 0, which will leave us with 5. So then that's basically it for our first step. And notice we still have this x3 spot open. That's because we still have to essentially try to get rid of this 2.5 here, or essentially make this a 0. So then that factor that we'll use will then go here. So we'll just leave that as x3 for now. So then what we can do is we can set up our matrices just a couple more times. I know it's a long process to write everything out, but it helps us stay organized. So we'll have our lower, we'll have our pivot matrix, and we'll have our upper. So before we start subtracting, what we want to check is we want to make sure that with this second pivot or the second value here, we're ignoring our first row because we already dealt with that. We're all good to go there because we have 0, 0, so we're all set. Now for this second value, we want to basically ask ourselves, is the absolute value of negative 0.1 greater than the absolute value of 2.5? And in this case, it would be no. So what we actually have to do is we have to swap these two rows so that our 2.5 is actually in the place where our negative 0.1 is. And remember, this is because of accuracy. Because if we have, let's say, this negative 0.1 and we were to subtract essentially our row 3 by our row 2 with this negative 0.1 here, it would actually lead to a less accurate result for our final x vector. So what we can do is we can essentially indicate that row 2 is going to swap with row 3. So for our first row here and the upper triangular matrix, that's not going to change because we're not swapping that. So we can leave that as is. But then for the second row, that would be 0, 2.5, and 5. And then the third row would be 0, negative 0.1, and 6. So now the question is, how does this change our lower triangular matrix? Well, in this case, for the first row again, so that won't change. And then, in fact, our 1s and our 0s will never change in our lower triangular matrix. No matter how much you essentially switch around your rows, the 0s and the 1s on that diagonal in the upper half, that will not change. But what we'll also have is, since we're essentially flipping our row 2 and our row 3, this x3 will actually stay the same because that won't swap places with our 1 because we have to have that diagonal of 1s for the lower triangular matrix to essentially follow the same format. So what we'll actually do is we'll just switch our two factors, the 5/10 and the negative 3/10. And that's pretty much all we have to do for our lower triangular matrix. And then now for the pivot matrix, this is where we actually do some switching as well. So the first row here, that's gonna stay the same. But we are gonna swap our second and third row to essentially change our B value later on. And we'll definitely get to this and we'll talk about it more. But we're essentially switching our second and our third row, just like the lower and the upper triangular matrices. So now we're actually ready to go to essentially get rid of this negative 0.1 and clean things up, and then we can start to solve. So let's write out all of our matrices one more time, I promise. This is the last time. So we'll have our upper triangular matrix, our lower triangular matrix, and then we'll have our pivot matrix. So now the first row of the upper triangular will not change, and the second row will not change, but the third row is going to change. And then for our lower triangular matrix, so the ones and the zeros, again, those will never change. And then we'll have the 5/10 and the negative 3/10 and whatever our x3 value is. Now for the pivot matrix, since we already made our row swapping, we don't have to essentially swap anymore. So we can leave the pivot matrix as is. So now the last thing that we have to do to essentially get this ready to start to solve is we'll want to modify our row 3 to try to get this value here to be a 0 as well as that value. So we can essentially start out by doing pretty much the same method as before by finding our factor. So we'll subtract by this negative 0.1 divided by the 2.5. So we'll have double negative and then 0.1 divided by 2.5 times R2 this time. So now what we can essentially do is we'll have negative 0.1 plus 0.1 divided by 2.5 times 2.5, which will give us 0. And then from before, this was already 0 because we have 0 plus something times 0. We're just going to get 0. And then for this next part, so we'll have 6 plus 0.1 divided by 2.5 times 5, or essentially 6 plus 0.2. So we're left with 6.2. And now we can actually fill in that last part to our lower triangular matrix, which is going to be negative 0.1 divided by 2.5. So now we actually have our three matrices. So we can circle these here because we've finished essentially part one. We have our upper triangular matrix, our lower triangular matrix, and we have our pivot matrix. So now we can start to solve for our x vector. So we can say solve for curly brace to denote a vector x. And then from before, let's grab our b vector here, this 1, 2, 3 column vector. So we'll write here that b is equal to 1, 2, 3. Sweet. So now, to essentially write out our format, we'll have the lower triangular matrix times the upper triangular matrix times our vector x, and that will be equal to the pivot matrix times b. Now, you might be eager just to solve across and say, okay, L times U times X is equal to P times B, and then you can try to like back solve or something like that. But what we'll actually want to do is we'll want to first let Y be equal to U of X, because in the end, this is all for trying to get the best precision that we possibly can. So by following this method, we should get the best precision for our X vector in the end. So then, what we should get is that L times our vector y is going to be equal to p times b. So what we can say is we can start to evaluate. So I'm actually going to steal these matrices up here. So we'll take the lower triangular, place that here, and then we'll have some vector y. So we'll have y1, y2, and y3, because we don't know those values quite yet. And then we'll go up here, and then we'll take our pivot matrix, bring that down, and then we'll multiply by our vector b, which was, leave 1, 2, 3. Yes. So then, what we can start to do is we can actually solve this part first, which will make things a little bit easier. So the way we're going to do this is essentially multiply, so we'll have 1 times 1, plus 2 times 0, plus 3 times 0. So we'll be left with 1 as our first value. Then we'll have 1 times 0, 2 times 0, and then 3 times 1. So then we'll have 3. And then our last value will be 2. So now we have our modified B vector. And the reason that we kept the P matrix along is to actually modify our B vector. So that's in the right order so that it corresponds with the correct equation. So now we can actually start to solve. So we'll essentially use forward elimination first, because we're going to start from the front and we're going to work our way all the way down. Because off the bat, it's pretty easy, because we can say that y times 1 plus y2 times 0 plus y3 times 0, well, that's just going to leave us with y1 plus 0 plus 0 is equal to, and then we have 1 over here. So you imagine just following along your rows and then just solving across like a system. So now we know that y1 is 0. So then we could say that 5 over 10 times y1, which is 1, plus y2 is going to be equal to 3. Hence, y2 is going to be equal to 2.5. Now the next step is negative 3/10 times y1, which is 1, plus, minus 0.1 divided by 2.5 times y2, which is 2.5, plus y3 is equal to 2. Hence, y3 is equal to 2.4. Now we're halfway done through solving for x, because now we have our y vector. So then the next step, so we can say then u times x is equal to y. So we can go back up here just to save some time, and we can steal our upper triangular matrix. So I'll take that and I'll paste it down here. Now we'll have some sort of x vector from before, so x1, x2, and x3. And we'll set that equal to our y vector that we solved for. So we have 1, 2.5, and 2.4. And now we can start to solve from the bottom, or essentially use back substitution to solve going up. So off the bat, we have that 6.2 times x3 is equal to 2.4. Hence, x3 is going to be equal to 0.3871. And then we'll have 2.5 times x2 plus 5 times x3, which is 0.3871, is going to be giving us x2 as 0.2258. And then to round things off, we'll have 10 times x1 minus 7 times x2, which is 0.2258. And then we'll have essentially just plus 0, and that'll give us that x1 is equal to 0.2581. So we'll have a final x value or x vector of 0.2581, 0.2258, and 0.3871. So now you know how to use PLU factorization to essentially solve a system of equations.